Let us bow our heads for a short word of prayer. Father God, we thank you for this time that we can come once again to spend some precious time with you. We pray for your Holy Spirit to open our hearts that we may be receptive to what your word has in store for us. As we listen to Pastor Dr. Michael Yusuf share about the book of Revelation, we pray, Lord, it will be a mighty blessing to each one of us. Help us, Lord, to understand it and to obey your word. We offer all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
And as we reach chapter 6 in the book of Revelation, we are really reaching the heart of the book. John beholds the Lord Jesus, the Lamb of God, who is alone worthy to be able to reveal the secrets and open the deeds of the earth. And the first of the seals represents a long process, a long series of events that begin in heaven and consummated on the earth. A seal that is broken in heaven, a horseman come upon the earth. Each seal that breaks in heaven introduces tragedy, passing all proportion of anything that we've ever known on the earth. And with the breaking of the first seal, the darkest period in human history, the darkest time the world has ever known, known as the time of tribulation, is going to take place. This 7-year span of future world history is graphically described from Revelation 6:1 to Revelation 19:21. This is going to be the bleakest of all times on the planet. These 7 years are the subject of Revelation 6 to 19. Those are about the end of time. And if you take Revelation 6 to 19, read it very carefully and very thoroughly, and then begin to compare it with what Jesus said in Matthew 24 about what is going to happen before he comes into the earth, you'll be absolutely amazed, not only at the details, but at the chronological order that they both follow. Here's what Jesus said. There's going to be wars, famine, death, martyrdom, moon and the sun will be darkened, the stars will fall, and it's going to be a time of divine judgment. Chapter 6 of Revelation, we see the first of three chronological judgments. The seven seals, the seven trumpets, and the seven bowls, and they will follow one after the other. And in the first set of judgment, those seals that we're going to look at, six of them today, you notice the incredible portrayal of man's inhumanity to man. This is what the Holy Jesus Christ told John in his revelation about the man of sin, about sorrow, about judgment. And the first four of these seven seals, as they break, as the Lord Jesus Christ break them one after another, the first four represented by riders of horses, by horsemen. The first horse is going to be white, representing the false kind of peace. The second rider is going to be a red horse, representing war. The third horse is going to be black, representing famine. The fourth horse is going to be pale color or ashen color or corpse color, representing death. First, you see the Lamb of God, who is alone worthy to open the seals, open the first one. And the first seal ushers the coming of the Antichrist. The first horseman is in white, representing the man of peace, who is really the man of sin. And the Bible said that he has a bow in his hand, but no arrow, only a bow. He is coming in some sort of a peaceful diplomacy. He is a master diplomat. This false man of peace is wearing a false crown. It has no diadems in it. He, in reality, as some would say, going to be a cool customer, because he's going to deceive a lot of people, including folks in the church. They're going to say, isn't that wonderful? He's bringing peace into the world. And when he's going to come, he's going to come at a time when the masses are tired of dictatorship, when the masses are tired of tyranny, when the masses are tired of oppression and political oppression, and everyone is longing for peace, and he's going to come, and he said, I am the man of peace. And this master diplomat will offer freedom, is going to offer prosperity, and the whole world is going to fall for it. In fact, he's going to mesmerize everybody. He's going to have such hold and power that whenever he speaks, the world is going to listen. although this world figure supposedly going to provide peace, but the masses going to revolt, he is incapable of giving the real peace that the Lord Jesus Christ alone can give you and give me. And because of his incapability, the second seal is going to break. There's going to be a war. Verses 3 and 4, the rider of this horse is going to be a red horse symbolizing war. For after this artificial time of peace, after this superficial kind of peace, there's going to be a break of war. And this horseman on the red horse is going to have a big sword with him. Is it the sword of nuclear weapon? Is it the sword of chemical warfare? I don't know. And after that comes the third seal, verses 5 and 6. This third horseman comes in riding on a black horse, which stands for famine, which stands for economic collapse. And the scripture said that this particular horseman is going to have scales or balance in his hand, indicating the scarcity of food. And the rider of the black horse is instructed not to touch the wine and the oil, which is traditionally known as the food of the rich. Why? Because nobody's going to afford it anyhow. Fourthly, that's the fourth seal, verses 7 and 8. This is the horse of the color of corpse, pale horse. You see, the death rate from the sword and from the famine in the first 21 months of the 7-year tribulation is going to be so tragically high. 1/4 of the world population, 1/4 of the world population, by the time of the fourth seal is broken, they'll be dead. To put it in today's figures, that is more than 1.5 billion people are going to die. He said they will not only die a physical death, but eternal death as well. He said death and Hades, death or hell in some translations that you have. Then there is the fifth seal, verses 10 and 11. In this seal, they're going to be the martyr's witness. Then there's the sixth seal. And this seal, the last one in this chapter, spills catastrophe. All the way, verses 12 to 17. The moon and the sun will be darkened, just as Jesus said. The stars will be falling. And there are going to be earthquakes of such magnitude that will make the San Francisco earthquakes like a picnic. Because this catastrophe is going to bring about a horrendous collapse and changes in the physical earth. So much so that the scripture said, hide us from the face of him who's sitting on the throne, from the wrath of the Lamb. It's going to be a very sad day. And it's my prayer that none of you are going to see that day. That none of us be there. And I believe that is possible. If you turn your life to the Lord Jesus Christ today, if you haven't already done so, would have run out. He has given the world chance after chance, opportunity after opportunity. And I want to urge you, if you have never surrendered your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, don't take the love of God lightly. Don't fall in the trap of thinking that a loving Christ will not judge you. That is not in the scripture. The Bible said the God of love sent his son. He did all he could. And he's saying to you, turn to him. Because one day the door is going to shut. There's going to be a final day. And if you come and you surrender to him today, this end does not have to be your end. You don't have to go through this. If you say, Lord God, I come to you and I surrender my life to you. I want you to be the Lord of my life. I want to honor you and glorify you in this life so I can be with you in heaven. If God brought you today to hear this message, the message of love and the message of judgment, and God is saying, now turn to me. This is for you. It's not for the benefit of anybody else. It's between you and the Lord. But you make that decision. Say today, Lord, I will turn to you. Forgive me my sins. Forgive me my willfulness. And now I come to you. I surrender to you. I give you my life. Lead me and guide me and take me to heaven when the day comes.